Diabelli Machines, which is the title of this presentation, six. Diabelli Machines is one of the projects currently developed by my research cluster, Music Experiment 21. And we decided to present to you this particular project as a way to communicate many of the main features of the research cluster. I will start by talking about the research cluster, which is hosted here at the Orpheus Institute since 2013, and it will run until January 2018. And we are benefiting from a European Research Council starting grant, which facilitates a lot of things. I want to start by reading with you the title of the cluster, so that you really get what it is about. Experimentation versus interpretation, exploring new paths in music performance in the 21st century. So the project is very clearly about music performance, mostly of past musical works. It aims at developing new paths, new ways of doing music performances of past musical works. And it takes a fundamental exploratory kind of approach, going into the unknown. By doing so, it challenges dominant notions of musical interpretation, which, as you can see in the main title, we put a bit provocatively in opposition to experimentation. And experimentation is our main approach, main method of work, our modus operandi is defined through an experimental attitude, of which you'll see some examples during my presentation. With this, we aim at generating new practices and also new modes of thinking. You also see how relevant it is for us, the strong link between our practice and our thinking. And they become blurred, they become the same thing at some point. We, in a nutshell, could say that Music Experiment 21, which is the nickname of this project, sometimes also ME21, you'll listen to this, ME21, we could say, in a nutshell, the purpose is to make the future. So not so much to analytically investigate the past of past musical works, or historiographically, or organologically, but much more to explore new possibilities, to generate new futures for past musical works. Now, when it comes to making the future as a performer, we think there are a couple of necessary conditions a performer, he or she, has to embrace. First, stop playing, think. What I mean by this, go beyond commonsensical notions of what is performance, of what is playing an instrument or an ensemble, what is music in general. Take risks. Normal musical education trains us to reduce risks in the moment of performance. On the contrary, we state very strongly one should enhance risk-taking, because only really high risk on stage can lead to high gains. And finally, play. Experiment. Of course, this is in dialogue in the first condition. Stop playing the way you were educated to do, you always did, and play with a really, truly experimental attitude, going into the unknown. Now, why is this playing so important? Because the situation of being on stage is the perfect situation to problematize our practices, our ways of thinking, and the works we deal with. We can problematize them, of course, in a written essay, in a discourse, we can. But for us as performers, and particularly doing artistic research, we must remain artists, and we must claim everyday stage as our preferential place to expose our problematizations. And one very simple reason why this is so is that well, most of you are performers, so you understand perfectly. The moment you start the performance, you're at the stage, you are not in a totally stable situation. Unexpected things will happen, necessarily. Mistakes might happen. Wrong phrases might happen. And you are not also in a totally unstable situation, because you know you are on stage, you know which piece you are playing, you know where you are going to in the overall dramaturgy. So what the performance situation is a meta-stable system between stability and instability. And this is a dynamic system. We are in the flow and we are in the move. Now, this particular quality performance shares with musical works. Because musical works, at least for music experiments in particular, are not totally stable entities, as maybe some Platonist music philosophers would like to have them, nor are they totally unstable, as maybe deconstruction would like. Yeah? They are also metastable entities. And please think with me just the innumerable objects and things that allow us in our brain to construct an image of any given work, sketches of that work, editions of the work throughout time, recordings of the work, performances of the work. All these things is what allow us to think about the work, to build an image of work. And all those things are part of this meta-stability. They have more stable or more unstable components. So it is this profound link between the meta-stability of performance situation and the work that we try to enhance through our practices. Meta-stability, as I just said before, puts you in a dynamic system. Therefore, with a transformational power. Once you are in the move, you can go in many directions at every single point, also in the performance. And it is this transformational power that might really generate new forms of creativity for performers. I insist the way I understand creativity for performers is not the little, very intelligent way to phrase better, less agogic or more agogic or a bit more pedal. That's very intelligent. I'm talking really about taking very creative decisions and doing them on stage. As I said at the beginning, our Diabelli Machines project, which deals with Diabelli variations, is one project in ME21. We have many other projects. For example, on Schumann Kreisleriana, where we have the Grasch series of projects. We have the Luigi Nono piece for piano and tape. We have several works by Arnold Schoenberg, the Goldberg variations, we have projects on that. And we have very special projects on the music, musical compositions of the philosopher Nietzsche. And we have many smaller projects here in Bulgaria done by doctoral students or postdocs in ME21. And very often, when I talk about these pieces, people ask me one thing, is why these pieces? What is the rationale behind the choice? And I like to reply in two moments. And first, let's just think together. Imagine one of these boxes disappears, gets out of the picture. Just imagine one of them, put it out of the picture. Nothing substantially changed. Because we are not doing research on this piece or research on that piece. We are doing research on the conditions of performance in general of any given musical piece. And the second moment of my reply is that, yes, and there are, on top of that, some particular reasons why these pieces are there. I can think of many other pieces being here. What these pieces have in common, at least one feature, and you all know these pieces, one thing they have in common, the moment they were composed, so the moment the composer put them in the world for the first time, when they emerge, appear in the world, all these particular pieces operate with a fundamental change. In a way or another, they made something thinkable that was unthinkable before they were composed. So these pieces have a particular power. They are what I like to call singularities. And maybe any other piece that I would add to this table probably should have that quality also. To make hearable something that was not hearable before. To make perceptible something that was not perceptible before. Or even to change what is music in general. Some of these pieces change how you think. What is music? So this quality of the unthinkable, making it thinkable, it's also something that ME21 is very much trying to foster and to make thinkable many practices that we might not even think about. I would like now to make a test with you, with the audience. I will play you a fragment of a piece. It's 25 seconds long only. And the question is not so much what is the piece, but who is the composer? That's my question to you. Who composed the 25 seconds I will play now? So if any of you knows the piece, please refrain from replying. Just for those that don't know the piece, the question is simply, who is the composer? And you can just shout in the middle afterwards, or after me.
Diabelli.
I need more replies. Come on, this is not enough. Nietzsche. We have Nietzsche here. Take risk.
I was thinking Bach, but I'm not sure.
No, Bach.
Schoenberg.
Brahms. So wait, let me remind you. We have Schumann, Nietzsche, Brahms, Diabelli, Schoenberg. Okay, fine, I can live with that.
Wittgenstein.
Very good, also another philosopher with music interests, yeah. So this, what I played you are just five bars of number 30 of the Diabelli variations by Beethoven. And the point of this first test is that precisely, I just wanted to show to you that Beethoven managed in this piece to create some spots where there is a kind of a tunnel that brings you to another time rather than his own time. Yeah? No one said Beethoven, for example. The closest we got was Diabelli. But we got Brahms, Schumann, Brahms, Schoenberg, yeah, and Wittgenstein, I think. So the point here was just these openings towards the future, towards other times. And We make now an intermezzo about the Diabelli variations, about the compositional process. Remember, we are not really investigating the piece, but we do research on the pieces, and we might come to new results. In the Nono project, we came to new results, for example, at this level. But here I'm relying on William Kinderman's notable book on Diabelli variations. And the important thing is that the Diabelli variations are composed in two moments, in two waves of composition. First, in 1819, where he wrote 23 variations, a substantial amount of music. Then he composed the Missa Solemnis, complete, and, for example, the three last piano sonatas. He started the Ninth Symphony, which will conclude shortly after finishing the Diabelli. And the Diabelli variations, Beethoven came back in 1823, making the final version as we know it today. Now, it's interesting to look at the differences between the 1819 version and the 1823. In 1819, these are the variations Beethoven composed, and we are putting the numbering of the final version, as we all know them, as you can put in a CD record player today. So you see, for example, that the first variation in 1819 was the one we now know as the number 3. In 1823, Beethoven composed 11 new variations, and as it's clear, he did not just add them at the end, no. He placed them in very strategical places between the previous ones. Interesting that the 1819 sequence of events remained exactly as it was in 1819. It's just these additions, that substantial change. It's important to remember that these 11 variations are not one-third of the composition, but are 52% of the duration of the composition. So the new addition is very substantial. If we look more in detail at 1823 variations, we discover that they are all parodies, all without a single exception. And if you look at the 1819, you have two parodies, 32-22. Well, 32 is what would be the fugue, and we just have four or five bars, and it's not the same theme, so we can dismiss that one. What really matters is 22. 22, and what is Beethoven parodying there in 1819? It's very explicit. In the score, he wrote Variation 22 after Mozart's Notte Giorno Faticare. And this is the famous entry scene of Mozart's opera, Don Giovanni. Terrible, and wants to be a free man and also have his own services and servants, etc. Of course, he will not manage agreement till the end of his day as a servant. But the point, one of the points is that many things have been written about how this was important to Beethoven, this master-slave relationship, which can be seen in relation to the theme of Diabelli or to the political conditions of the day even. But for us, what is really important is that with this Mozart party, Beethoven apparently found a way, referring to Mozart, composition in 1787, that Mozart was from the time of Beethoven, they met personally, Beethoven found a way to relate to other times. If you look at Variation 23, the next one, he's parodying a famous piano etude by Kramer. Crack. caricature. So you see a completely different way of parodying past music. If we go to the next variation, 24, totally different story. Beethoven is making a parody, very elaborate, with Bach's chorale for keyboard. And I will do now a second test with you. This is easier. I will play for you the variation 24 in full. And I will play for you Bach's chorale in full also. So I play both pieces. But I will intermingle them. And I can tell you, I will start with Beethoven and I will finish with Beethoven. So you know this. The test, the question to you is, whenever you think I shifted to Bach or I shifted back to Beethoven, just signal that. You can, in this case I play, you can just shout or raise your hands or do something that you notice. Just, yeah, something like this, yeah. And I will not play it again, so because it's quite long music. But you understood the point? So just signal in any way when I shift from Bach to Beethoven or vice versa. Signal anything? Yeah, a couple of people. So because I was not seeing, how often did I change? 8 times, 6 times, 5, 4, 2, 1, 0.
Maybe 2 times.
So 2 times this means in, out.
Yeah.
That was it. Some more?
About 6. But
sorry?
6. I mean, counting ins and outs separate.
Okay. Well, the point is not so much exactly how often I came in and out, I will not tell you. The point is precisely just that it's clear that Beethoven here in his Variation 24 achieved a kind of morphing between his own counterpoint style of writing and Mozart's counterpoint chorale kind of style. So it generates a kind of trans-historical style, which is not Bach, is not Beethoven, is both. Bach became Beethoven, Beethoven became Bach, or something like this. This was the point. And if we look to the others now very quickly, Variation 25, for example, and 26, but for that matter, you have a kind of variations on early 19th century dance music. It's a bit of Schubert, Lendler there, something like this. And you remember the Diabelli's theme is a waltz. So Beethoven's making fun of this folklore kind of popular form of dance. Variation 28 is very interesting case. It's a variation about his own style. It's quoting a kind of his own particular musical gestures are being quoted there. 29, completely different. 29 is one of the shortest in the whole set, and it's a variation on a Baroque lament. So you have a kind of old Baroque style compressed into 25, 30 seconds of music. 31, very complex, very intellectual variation, because it's not explicit, but it is, he's quoting 25th of the Goldberg variations. At the same time, his own adagio from the Hammerklavier sonata, the rhythms. So, and it's of a different quality than 24, because here they remain, it's two works. It's not the style of Bach and the style of Beethoven, it's really the Goldberg and the Hammerklavier. In variation 32, which is developed in 1823, the famous fugue, it is clearly the monumental Handel style. Yeah? And we could continue 33, the Haydn, Menuet, etc., etc. The point is, as you can already see, Beethoven in 1823 made a kind of mini history of music up until himself. Yeah. So he found these perforations to the past and integrated them in this particular piece of music. So we like to think of Diabelli's variations as a time machine where elements of the past might be excavated and might enter the machine. And once they are inside the machine, there are machinations that at some point might project them into the future. And what you have here is actually the two tests I made just for you. The past entering the machine is the second test, is the Bach entering Beethoven. The future is the first test. That's why you replied Wittgenstein and Schoenberg and Brahms and Schumann. So this is and this project in this respect was very important for the overall framework of ME21 because it showed a new way of thinking musical works and for looking for these moments of perforation towards other times. So this is the time machine. Can we have the next slide, please? Yeah, the next step. This is what we did afterwards. Okay, let's think further. Let's try to, what happens if we integrate really future works that could not be predicted at all by Beethoven or in his style? And in order to do this, what we did was we commissioned totally new pieces to young, living, of course, composers to write some new pieces to replace some of the Diabelli variations in the concert situation. And we will listen now to one of such commissions. It's, I think, about 4.5 minutes long, so just the audio recording. Thank you. 14, composed by David Gorton, who's here, and we used it to replace variation 14 from the original piece. And David Gorton said something about his work.
I'm particularly interested in Beethoven's music, particularly the late piano repertoire. And my favourite variation from this piece is variation 14. So when I was asked to write either a response or a series of my own variations, the first thing I wanted to do was to have a go at variation 14. And then it made sense to me that variations 12 and 13 preceding it would be the perfect sort of length to fit with the requirements of the project. Well, variation 14, I think, is a very special moment in the piece, but it has that similar kind of static and very silent sort of experience that you get in the Arietta movement of Opus 111, for example. It's a sort of very otherworldly, very still moment, and I'm particularly drawn to that, or always have been. So I thought that would work extremely well for ensemble, particularly for ensemble with sustaining instruments. Well, I wanted to stay very close to the Beethoven indeed, and I kept all three variations a lot of the rhythmic structures intact, so that you could really still hear the Beethoven coming through.
So you just heard how David wanted to keep intact some of the rhythmic structures. So he was also morphing his own style with Beethoven's style, just the way Beethoven did with Bach, also morphing, keeping the rhythm, etc. So this was just to give you an idea of what kind of futurities we are bringing into the machine and seeing what effects it has in that same machine. So this is just a scheme of our fourth instantiation of this project, which was 1 year ago with the concert, and you see the sequence of events here. So you see the David Gorton piece there, 14, 13, 12. You see the other composers, right? Van Parra, Tiziano Maglia, Bart van Ecke, Hans Rons, Paolo Gallo is also there. Most of them are here today. And we are operating at different layers and levels. You see, for example, just after the first time I played the theme, we have variation 3, 4, 5. So we are kind of simulating 18-19 version. Then when we have variation 1 and 2, before that, I play the theme again. So to say, okay, we are now in 1823. And because I also think Beethoven thought the theme differently, but that's a different story, not for me. And you see another thing is the yellowish squares. These are transcriptions. Because the theme and some other variations, I play on solo piano as the original. And then you have the contemporary music ensemble playing these new pieces. And to bridge the sonic gap between these, I thought about doing a lot of transcriptions. Some variations are the transcriptions of the original Beethoven. And I did many different kinds of approaching the variation, the transcription technique. For example, the number 3, I used the classical trio. So it's a variation very much, it would have been possible that Beethoven wrote it for 3. And it sounds like this.
Thank you.
just by simply transcribing it, the way Beethoven is registering the instrument, becomes, it sounds like Schumann or Brahms, more than a Beethoven trio. And a completely different kind of transcription, variation 16, for example, where I try to go to a sonic world very alien to Beethoven. Electronics. We'll just make you now one live example. When are you ready? Which is the famous passage, the transition between the fugue, variation 32, to the finale, variation 33. And Beethoven, after the cadenza of the piano, wrote these couple of chords, very enigmatic, and a lot has been written about them. And it's all about resonances and waiting. And what we did there is what you will see now. So I'm going to cadenza. Just to give you an idea. We use this three or four times, not very much, but just with this one. If you are curious now about the Diabelli Machines project, you can find us on this link, which is on the postcard we gave you. It's on the postcard, the first link there. From there, you will access a research catalog entry with all the versions, and from there, you can click every instantiation as a single research catalog entry. You have more materials, you have the concerts, for example, divided in their parts. You have a full recording, but you have all the parts. It's very easy to navigate. You have the interviews with all the composers. You have the sketches produced by the composers. You have our approach to the project. And we also have, I think it's the second link in your postcard, we have a simulation of the version from 1819. So you can go there and listen, how was this piece sounding in Beethoven's mind between 1819 and 1823? Okay, so at this point, we come now to ME21 general features, because I think now you are in a perfect position to understand some of our main characteristics. So if we're still linking with Beethoven, you remember our work? If you think of things like Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach's treatise on the art of playing the keyboard, or on the grammar etudes, I mean, all those things that were already in the world before Beethoven started composing the Diabelli variations, all those things we call para-strata, built kind of the ground that was there before. Other kind of things are sketches to the Diabelli variations, or letters where Beethoven is describing how difficult it was to write this piece. So all the materials that a composer uses, produces while composing the piece we call substrata. But then, afterwards, there are, for example, editions of the piece throughout time, until today and in the future. There are theoretical works, like Kinderman's wonderful book. All these materials that appear in relation to a work, but afterwards, we call epistrata. And of course, there are recordings of the piece, there are performances of the piece, there are even literature works coming out from the piece. Those we call metastrata. And last but not least, we can think of bringing into relation with the given piece something, a piece or a painting, that has no objective relation with them, like Morton Feldman's King of Denmark, which we brought in our very first instrumentation in dialogue with Beethoven. This we call allostrata. Now, if you follow me with this strata, and every strata, of course, is full of things, layered. I just want to mention there are many, but at least three ways of looking at strata that I wanted to stress now. And we are going for the third. But the first one, you can think of a musical work in a very, what I call a monumental way. So you think of one manuscript, Fassung letzter Hand, they say in German. That is the absolute piece. Or one edition, or one recording. Or one performance that you listened when you were 15 years old, that remained, that is the Diabelli Variations for you. If you monumentalize this, of course, you are not so interested in knowing about other editions and different editions or the sketches, because actually that doesn't matter. What matters is the monumental work you have in your mind. Another way of looking at the strata is to say, no. All these strata are full of things. All the sketches, all the little instruments the composer used, all the editions of the future, and you enter what I call a kind of antiquarian approach, and you go into this, and of course, if you are in this mode of thinking, you give so much value to every single little object you find that the monumental vision disturbs you. You don't want to have the monumental vision. You want to stay to the ends. You have a love to all these little things. A third option, the one ME21 wants to embrace and explore, is to acknowledge all these strata, is to go for them, and to look at them critically, not giving any of them a preference in the first instance. Yeah. And with this kind of approach, we came to a research method that is being developed by ME21, which is a tripartite methodology. We start with what I call the archaeological moment. You go into the world and you look for your sources. You go to archives, you go to libraries. So you find your sketches, you find all the editions, you find analytical works, etc. You do the archaeology. At some point you identify all the things, or as much as possible, related to a given work you want to problematize, and you come home. And you have selected, and you enter the genealogical moment. You start looking for connectors and connections between some of these things. Yeah. And you select some of them, what I call singularities, at the level of the materials in the strata. You have singularities, materials that emanate more power than others. After that, you are in the little circle, you are at home in your working desk, you have your singularities, you establish your genealogy. That is the moment to problematize them in view of a concert, of a performative situation, might be in view of an article, in view of a CD or an installation, whatever. And then in that moment, when you problematize them, you create a new arrangement, a new redistribution of the same symbol. You have it there, and you present this, and in that moment you make a cut, is the here and now of the performance, or of the article, whatever, and in that moment, that thing enters the archaeological fundus. So we create a circularity, and that's one of the reasons why all our projects have a serial number, because it's the new instantiation of all this. And we think that the archaeological and the genealogical moment is two moments. We need a lot of scholarly academic methodology. Yes, we do need. If you go to an archive, you must know how to behave in an archive and how to extract information from the archive. It's not the place to play around. The genealogy and a lot of methods to think connections, but in the problematization, for us as artist researcher, this is where artistry really comes to the fore. You can problematize intellectually, of course, but for us, our particular take is the artistic problematization, and that is the ideal moment to do it. So, if you take our view on the strata, on the things, on the method, we can come to something that we are working on, we are suggesting, so it's still work in progress. But if we operate like ME21 is doing, we are doing more than execution of pieces. We do execute pieces, we play, I play pitches and rhythms, right, an instrument. But I'm doing more than that. We are doing more than an interpretation of pieces. Interpretation becomes one element, one parameter in a wider picture. We are doing performances, yes, but we are doing more. Because we are in an experimental approach. We are experimenting with unheard things, with unthinkable things that we try to make thinkable. And still, even this experimentation is just part of a wider picture where we are submersed. Yeah? And we are doing what we like to call musical operators. And what is the future? I don't know today, I don't know. What is the next box? If you look historically, there are a lot of treatises now about history of interpretation. More or less we know execution, vocal interpretation, performance, then nobody knows. We propose experimentation, we propose this word operator. Because the previous execution, interpretation, etc., mainly they reproduce already existing objects. And they have a tendency to be passive reproductions, even if they're very lively on the surface. But it's always the same, with intelligent differences, for intelligent audience to notice these differences. But we are aiming at really the generation of unprecedented artistic events based on past musical works. And with this musical operator going into the unknown, I conclude. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this wonderful presentation. Just one quite simple question. Yeah, you told us that the stage is so important for you, and you explained why, and I completely sympathize with that. There's also an audience. How much do you take care of the audience? Do you inform them about the fact that they are, might be part of the experiment? How much information do they get?
Good question. As a principle, I try to avoid being pedagogical. I try to avoid giving, for example, this kind of information I never give. But I think we have to create a situation where it is clear for people that they are not entering a regular traditional concert. Yeah? And so one of the things I do always is that I blur the beginning, the start situation. People never know when we start. So this, I already have many tactics to do this. So this means when the doors open, like half an hour or 1 hour before the performance, we are already acting on stage and doing some playing music. Yeah? So this is one simple example. And of course people enter and they immediately ask, already start, but it's not on time, so they understand something special. Another option, as we did 1 month ago in a performance of the Schumann project, we put ourselves on the floor in between the audience. And audience on stage also, but that's not the point. The point is that we are mixed with the instruments there and the chairs, you have couches, you have pillows. So immediately people understand they are not entering, you know, a Carnegie Hall kind of piano recital. That's very clean. So they are already kind of, they have time to prepare for something particular. And I think also the titles we give to our performances, you see it's not a regular concert, because the titles are always like Diabelli Machines 6 or different serial numbers. We have many reasons for those, but everything creates a situation where the audience very quickly understands this will not be, I mean, this is not a performance. When we do this, a lot of Diabelli variations are played, but this is not a performance of the Diabelli variations as you know them. Yeah. So this is my quick reply to this question.
Thank you also for the very inspiring presentation. I have a couple of very brief questions. They are the same theme, of the same theme. You used the word parody of Beethoven's use of earlier music. Do you understand them as parodic, and why? And the other question is the strata, in which ways are they related to intertexts and different genres of intertexts?
Yes, okay. Very good. The parody is not my invention. This is a concept, as you know, in music theory, the concept of parody is very used. In this case, for example, the Book of Kindermann, he identified most of them. I identify two or more that he didn't consider parody, but it's just in the sense that whether there are stylistic parodies or parodies of the theme is when Beethoven is simply referring explicitly or implicitly to a specific piece from the past. Doesn't mean that he's making fun of that piece. Yeah? For example, the Kramer Etude is making a caricature of the Etude, but Kramer was the only pianist in Vienna that Beethoven really respected and admired, and he wrote it a couple of times in letters. So it's not making fun of Mozart or Bach. It's in an intellectual, elaborated style, referring to a piece. It's parody in this sense. As for intertextuality, yes, of course, that is the genealogical moment that comes to the fore, or transtextuality, etc. But with the strata, what I really mean is, I mean, I am proposing here, if I may say here, a materialist ontology. So I am saying there are no essences, there are no substances, there are no such things as platonic musical works. For me, that's really planet X outside of the solar system. What there are material objects that we can find in this world, very concretely, sketches, letters. Franz de Reuter just have quoted me on this section where I have this beautiful, and my text is better than my speech, so that was perfect. All the innumerable things. And I only take these material things as part of the strata. And I mean really physical objects that we can grasp, that we can touch. And that's the base of my, it's a very materialistic ontology in this sense. And my first gesture is to say, all these things, when I, first moment, they are all equal. All equal. There's no edition better than the other. There's no superiority of Urtext regarding 19th century editions. There's no superiority of a sketch on the other. Then, when I start looking at them very carefully for my purposes, I start making my extracting my singularities. So that's the sense. And then the intertextuality is the moment after. So first is the materiality. Only then comes meta-trans-textual. Peter.
Oh, I speak very well.
It's
a very wonderful and very creative presentation, very clear. Is this a proto-method for the work with all the other composers? Do you use the same idea of performance, interpretation, experimentation when you work with Nomo?
Yes.
That's the show. So this is actually...
What is very specific here is just this time machine, the traveling of time, because this is very specific. Beethoven created this. But the strata, the methodology, all this I apply to all my projects more and more consciously now as I am writing my monograph and I want to be precise about this. So I do a little bit fix things more than I like, but I have just for the communication to do. This is a general approach, and you can find in any of our projects, the last part could be the same. Mm-hmm. Yeah?
So this is actually proposing a very specific method for artistic
absolutely.
Music.
Absolutely. I'm not saying this is the method, it would be totally stupid. It's my proposal, also my offer to the community, because, as you know, always the question, artistic research, they have no methods. What kind of methods do they use? And I'm saying we have all the methods of all other disciplines in the archaeology, you know, all them from musicology, all, and in addition, we have our own specific methods, and we can create new methods according to our how we think musical works. But this is the problem really of ontology, because if you think musical work in a Platonic view or Aristotelian view, you cannot agree with me. And so this is we have to slowly build up the discourse. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. This Diabelli Variations is an example of some kind of also an insight of a discovery of musical history that Beethoven can actually think in these to consider the Western tradition as a certain kind of history that can be quoted, and it's a discovery in itself. But my question is basically, how much have you been in debate with musicologists? In which way this kind of idea of musical history differs from perhaps other contemporary theories? Can you
contemporary being today?
Today.
Yeah. Yes. That's a good question, and I could talk for hours about this actually. I would say, as I just said before, if you are coming from traditional dominant ontologies today, it's very difficult to follow me. What I can say is that I have the experience, especially this last year, where there are a group of musicologists and music theoreticians that very much embrace this as a new idea, new suggestion. I can name, it's not a mystery. Lydia Goethe, for example, is very excited about what I am proposing. Yeah? Or Gunnar Hindrich, the music philosopher, who was here last April. Or even an analytical philosopher like David Davis, they are very much in favor. But if you go to more conservative, if I may say so, like Peter Kivy, this kind of philosopher, very strong Platonists, or Walter Stoffer, etc., they cannot follow. They cannot. Because they block immediately the works, have essences, or have ideas somewhere in the metaphysical space. And that is, so I think with this proposal, I'm coming from the performative, so I'm not claiming I am a music philosopher, as they are, and they might live in planet X. I live here, and I go on stage, and they don't go. This, I think, makes a very important difference. And I'm making an ontology and a methodology for artists, researchers that go on stage or that compose music. And in that sense, I hope it is new, but because the field is new, it's not because that I am doing it. It's the whole field is new. And I'm just part of this, and I'm contributing with the method, yes, and a new vision of things. But this is clearly something that will take time to convince more traditional. But as I told you, I was just naming the musicology or music philosophy that I most admire. They have a kind of immediate sympathy with me. And those that obviously I struggle myself reading them, they struggle reading me. So, but yeah, it's a process. And you cannot like please everybody. So that's
thank you. It's absolutely fascinating. There's a dimension that I didn't see quite so much in there, which is the materials that are coming to support your work. I mean, as an example, the arrangements you're making of materials or the choices you're making are determined by the personalities within the cluster. If you had different players, different musicians, different sets of expertise, you would be drawn to potentially different solutions. But I didn't quite see that dimension in the...
Yeah, that's possible. I mean, I'm always pragmatic also. I know what I get. For the Nono project, I was in a fortunatissima position that I had the Orchestra of Cologne available with 100 musicians. So that's once in my life. And I had it, I could explore that. Yeah. Normally, I have to deal with small ensembles, or with just us.
Sure.
But you saw some of the concerts with ensemble Interface or ensemble Hermes, which are good 6, 7, 8 people. I can hire one or two more if I need. But the first time I did transcriptions was really just my pure fantasy. I just,
sure,
with no limitations. Then, of course, with the ensemble, that's so good, because as Stravinsky said, give me constraints in order to compose. Yeah. So that was...
No, it's simply at the level of methodology, that in acknowledging the equality of different materials from before and so on,
yeah.
it just seems that it's a necessary component of the final performative dimension,
yes.
Which may just need a little bit of
advocacy
as well.
Just on that, a comment on that, I tried to exactly from the material scenes from that I found, what I call the singularities or the particular sketches on etc. I tried to find what is the characteristic here that makes it singular, like the third variation. I think what makes it sound like Brahms, if I play it on the piano, it sounds a little bit like Brahms, but not that much.
Yeah.
It's the registration. It's going really apart. It's kind of very melodic things, but very apart. In 111, it goes with trills, and it's clearer, the separation. Here it's not. And if you think this is what Brahms normally does in his piano trios or string quartets even. So I understood, okay, it must be this. So if I put this in a string quartet, which I didn't yet, I can't think of, or in a piano trio, I might get to a sonic world a bit like Brahms.
Mm-hmm.
So it's from the material, what is immanent in the material, that is suggesting me how to change it for the particular performance.
It was more just at the level of archaeology that the choices you, for example, if your focus was, let's say, around a jazz ensemble, the sonic, even with the Brahmsian type approach, the tracing of that dimension of choice, there are some limits in the world, and at any given time. It's just when you're turning back towards archaeology at the post-performative point, that would be part of the trace that may be worth thinking through.
How we reintegrate things.
Yes, how to reintegrate.
Yeah, we do a lot.
Yeah.
This would be another talk.
Sure.
I mean, I'm just even today, in a way, I am reintegrating from the Diabelli 2, 3, 4. They were being, again, reiterated here in particular moments. Everything is a parameter, okay?
Thank you.
Oh, they are telling me time is off. Okay.